Tyrannosaurs are one of the best-studied dinosaur groups, and their most famous representative, Tyrannosaurus rex, is easily one of the most popular extinct animals of all time. Thanks to this century-long stardom, there tends to be a ton of press coverage about anything tyrannosaur-related, even if the news story in question doesn't have much to do with T-Rex itself at all, and a lot of it is, well, not exactly great. If you've been online within the last week or so, you might have seen one of these headlines that were part of the wave of pop science articles that sprung up in the wake of a trio of newly published studies on tyrannosaur biology and ecology that all happened to be released within a few days of each other. And because many of these articles are frankly fairly misleading, if not just straight up wrong, I figured I'd dedicate a quick video to clearing up the record. First up, the 2.5 billion T-Rex thing. Out of the three, this is the study that I personally found the most interesting, and it seems to be the one that most news outlets I've seen actually did a decent job at covering. The paper itself, published in the journal Science by a team from the University of California, Berkeley, and the San Diego Natural History Museum, is surprisingly short and just walks through the processes that ultimately led to the calculated estimations of T-Rex abundance, both at any given point during the species' existence, and the sum total of all individuals that ever lived. As many outlets have pointed out, the project initially just started as a question of what are the odds of finding a T-Rex fossil in the first place, and from there, the team calculated various variables and did some back-of-the-envelope extrapolations. Some things that are of note that most reports haven't pointed out. 1. The study is really just an estimate that counts the number of adults. This is due to the fact that only breeding-age individuals were considered as one of the variables, as well as the fact that juvenile T-Rex likely had different diets and ecological niches from the adults, meaning that the food and the space requirements were different and so were irrelevant for the purposes of the study. 2. The number of 2.5 billion is the median number and isn't meant to be taken as an exact estimate, despite the headlines. This requires a bit of understanding of how statistics work, but basically the median is the number in the middle of a set of data points, in this case the possible number of adult T-Rex that ever lived. The 95% interval means that the true answer is most likely somewhere between 140 million and 42 billion, based on the range of values drawn from the other parameters used to calculate this number. It's also worth noting that populations dynamically change over time in response to various environmental factors, so the true number of how many individual adult T-Rex were actually roaming at any given point certainly fluctuated, and the roughly 20,000 estimate is just an average. Overall, it's a neat little piece of science that was generally decently covered by the press, and provides a solid blueprint for future population estimates of other extinct creatures, and I'm actually tempted to try this out myself at some point down the road. The next story we'll look at probably got the most press coverage, judging by the number of articles discussing it, but this is also where some of the more blatant misconceptions start to fly. Based on a study published in PeerJ by an international team of researchers from the US and Australia, most of the stories you'll find say something along the lines of, new evidence of Tyrannosaur bone bed has been found showing that T-Rex were wolf-like pack hunters that lived in groups. This isn't quite right, or at least it overlooks a lot of mitigating factors. First of all, the animals found at this bone bed are not T-Rex, they're a much smaller earlier relative called Teratophaneus that lived about 78 million years ago in the Kaiparowitz Formation in southern Utah. Tyrannosaurus hasn't been found in rocks older than about 68 million years, and no fossils of the Tyrannosaurian king have been unearthed in Utah, at least to my knowledge. This doesn't mean that they weren't living in what is now Utah, since their range extends as far south as Texas and possibly even Mexico, but there's no evidence of their presence in Utah at this point. Sure, you could argue that nobody knows what Teratophaneus is, and so any mention of T-Rex is necessary to relate the story to an audience whose exposure to dinosaurs is pretty much just the Jurassic Park franchise. But about half the articles out there don't even mention Tyrannosaurus by name, though there is this cute attempt from USA Today. Something else that the coverage commonly overlooks is what was actually found at the site. Most articles just describe the bone bed along the lines of containing multiple individuals that died together during a flood, and then making the jump that this means pack living and hunting behavior. Based on this, you'd probably think that these animals were all adults, but an actual read of the paper itself, which is open access so anybody can see it for free, reveals that the bone bed contains the remains of a mixed age grouping, with one adult, one adolescent or subadult, two mid-sized juveniles, and possibly a fifth small juvenile that is only tentatively considered to be a tyrannosaur fossil, as opposed to any other small theropod like a dromaeosaur or ornithomimid. If we assume that these animals were all actually part of a single long-term social group, my first thought would be that this is a parent with multiple offspring from two, if not three, different broods, a behavior evidenced in other dinosaurs like Psittacosaurus. Even this assumption is a bit shaky, since we don't have a lot of data for teratophineous growth. The paper in its supplemental info doesn't describe the actual fossils, it just identifies them. But we do know that dinosaurs shifted ecological niches fairly drastically as they aged. You might recall that the aforementioned T-Rex population study excluded juveniles from its calculations specifically due to how different the young animals were in terms of build and thus diet from the adults, which suggests that mixed-age hunting groups might not have been much of a thing for T-Rex specifically, even if it was something that other less specialized and ecologically dominant tyrannosaurs might have been doing to some extent. One further, more minor point is that most reports give the impression that tyrannosaur group living and pack hunting is a brand new idea evidenced by this discovery. But it's actually been around for about 2 or 3 decades now, due to 2 other bone beds containing multiple Albertosaurus and Dasypletosaurus remains. Whether these finds actually suggest social living for these dinosaurs, as opposed to their being driven together into close proximity due to environmental factors like flooding, is beyond the scope of this video, so I won't get into it here, other than to say that it's not as conclusive as the news reports suggest. Finally, we come to perhaps the silliest of the 3 stories, not because the study is silly, but because the coverage of it somehow got weirdly twisted by a couple news sources. The Dutch study itself, published by the journal Royal Society Open Science, estimated the preferred walking speed of T-Rex based on the physics of its tail movement. Dinosaur tails had a variety of muscles and ligaments running their length, particularly the caudofemoralis muscle that connected to the back of the femur, and helped the animals power their legs. So figuring out how often their tails flexed during locomotion can give valuable insight into how often they were taking each step. Combining that data with fossilized trackways that are assumed to be of normal walking behavior, the researchers concluded that the preferred walking speed of T-Rex was a little under 3 miles per hour, which, while slower than previous estimates that only took the legs themselves into consideration, is well within the range of most modern animals from a variety of different families, from elephants to humans to wildebeest and emus. Somehow this got misinterpreted by a few outlets, most notably Live Science, which led to this headline. The bulk of the article itself is overall fine, but the misleading headlines and opening paragraphs don't really help, especially in our online culture where many people barely read past the headline of a given news story. One of the paleontologists involved in the study even changed his Twitter bio to mock and clear up the misconceptions. I'm not a journalist, but I think when your subject has to issue their own correction to your piece on their work, you likely messed up somewhere along the line. So that was a trio of Tyrannosaur news stories and the coverage surrounding them. I might do more of these media fact-checking things if the opportunity arises, and hopefully I'll have a more put-together format for them. News outlets and other pop-sci media sources tend to give some pretty weird or cliched takes on science topics, especially with paleontology and evolutionary bio, so there's ample content out there. Of course, feel free to let me know if you'd actually like to see more of this type of stuff. I'd also like to take this opportunity to note that I'm almost at 300 subscribers as the channel approaches its first anniversary, which is actually way more than I expected I'd have by now, and I really appreciate everyone tuning in. I'm working on a particularly special video to be released on May 18th in celebration of said anniversary, so do stay tuned for that. You can follow me on Twitter as I drop hints along the way. Many thanks, stay safe, and I'll see you next time.